Bună ziua. Bine ați venit la conferința de presă organizată ca urmare a încheierii Consiliului Informal de astăzi al Miniștrilor. Vor susține scurte declarații de presă domnul Petre Daea, președintele Consiliului, domnul Phil Hogan, comisarul european pentru agricultură, și domnul Paolo Castro, vicepreședintele Comitetului pentru Agricultură și Dezvoltare Rurală al Parlamentului European. Domnule ministru.
Da, este o plăcere deosebită. Astăzi, având alături doi oameni cu care am lucrat de-a lungul vremii, doi oameni foarte importanți în domeniul agriculturii europene, doi oameni care dețin și au deținut în această perioadă importante funcții la nivel european. Este vorba de comisarul Phil Hogan, un prieten bun al românilor, un prieten bun al tuturor acelora care s-au aflat în situații dificile, cum a fost cazul României în nenumărate rânduri, și când comisarul a intervenit cu sprijinul cuvenit pentru a da succes politicilor noastre în domeniu. De asemenea, este lângă noi astăzi, aici, și mă bucur tare mult, este prima dată când mă aflu într-o conferință de presă timp de 6 luni de zile într-un asemenea format, când există și un membru al Parlamentului și nu orice membru, este vicepreședintele Comisiei pentru Agricultură din Parlamentul European. Înainte toate, vreau să vă spun că mă simt onorat pentru faptul că această reuniune a Consiliului Informal s-a desfășurat la București, într-o locație deosebită, fiind de ultima lună de activitate în misiunea pe care cu prilejul exercitării de către România președinției Consiliului Uniunii Europene. Pe agenda reuniunii de astăzi s-au regăsit subiecte deosebit de importante, de actualitate pentru statele membre, în contextul noii politici agricole comune, respectiv cercetarea agricolă, inovarea și bioeconomia, crearea de sinergii și instrument principal în domeniul dezvoltării rurale. În cadrul întâlnirii informale s-au desfășurat de asemenea schimburi de opinii cu privire la aceste tematici majore, precum și o informare din partea președinției despre stadiul pregătirii candidatului unic al Uniunii Europene la postul de director general al FAO. Sunt alegeri foarte importante pentru care, prin efortul președințiilor anterioare, Uniunea Europeană a reușit de această dată să propună o candidatură unică și a doamnei Catherine Jeslin-Lanel, fiind prima femeie candidat pentru acest post de când FAO a fost fondată acum 70 de ani. Perioada de prezentare a candidaturilor pentru funcția de la director general FAO a fost deschisă la data de 1 decembrie 2018 până la data de 28 februarie 2019. Doamna Catherine Jeslin-Lanel și-a prezentat cererea la începutul lunii decembrie 2018. Am reiterat astăzi necesitatea de a readuce în discuție cercetarea agricolă și bioeconomie, elemente catalizatoare pentru agricultură, luând în considerare viitoarea reformă a politicii agricole comune. În domeniul agriculturii, cercetarea și bioeconomia reprezintă priorități cheie menite să permită fermierilor din țările Uniunii Europene alinierea la standardele tot mai înalte impuse de politica agricolă comună, mai ales de cele de mediu și climă. Vreau să subliniez, de asemenea, demersurile Uniunii Europene pentru susținerea cercetării și inovării concretizate în programul cadru de cercetare actual al Uniunii Europene Orizont 2020, politica de dezvoltare rurală și strategia pe termen lung, intitulată o abordare strategică a cercetării și inovării în domeniul agriculturii în Uniunea Europeană. În cadrul dezbaterii, discuțiile au fost legate de faptul că politicile solide și instrumentele adecvate au o deosebită relevanță pentru a asigura transmiterea către fermieri a cunoștințelor și a rezultatelor acestor cercetări. Dar ele fac de asemenea necesitate ca modernizarea în noua politică agricolă comună să se axeze în principal pe construirea unui sistem funcțional de cunoaștere și inovare agricolă și pe cooperarea și integrarea sectorului primar în lanțurile de valori bioeconomice pentru asigurarea dezvoltării durabile. Ideea unanim exprimată a fost aceea că în domeniul agriculturii cercetarea trebuie să joace un rol fundamental în dezvoltarea soluțiilor identificate pentru un viitor care să respecte obiectivele europene și pe cele de dezvoltare durabilă în conformitate cu specificul local. De asemenea, vreau să reamintesc o strategie bioeconomie durabilă pentru Europa, consolidarea legăturii dintre economie, societate și mediu, a fost actualizată de către Comisia Europeană în octombrie 2018, punându-se accentul în special pe conceptele de durabilitate și circularitate, cu scopul de a promova reînnoirea sectoarelor industriale, modernizarea sistemelor de producție primară, protecția mediului și îmbunătățirea biodiversității. În decembrie 2018, în cadrul Consiliului de Agricultură și Pescuit, miniștrii au realizat un schimb de opinii pe această temă, oficiale concentrându-și atenția asupra modului în care se poate valorifica potențialul bioeconomiei și a stimulării creșterii economice. În cadrul președinției României, Consiliul a reanalizat subiectul bioeconomiei în baza a trei aspecte propuse de țara noastră, care au vizat schimbul de bune practici, bioeconomia și viitoarea fac, bioeconomia în Uniunea Europeană. Astfel, președinția română a identificat bioeconomia drept una dintre prioritățile sale marcante, organizat în acest sens, organizând în acest sens conferința la nivel înalt privind cercetarea agricolă bazele de dezvoltare a agriculturii europene, zonelor rurale și a bioeconomiei, eveniment care a avut loc la București în data de 5 aprilie 2019. Această conferință a avut o serie de obiective ambițioase, precum identificarea soluțiilor care să permită o integrare largă a agriculturii în bioeconomie, în economia circulară și participarea mai amplă a țărilor din Europa de Est la programul Uniunii Europene pentru cercetare și inovare, Orizont 2020, stabilirea priorităților în domeniul cercetării agricole pentru a îndeplini noile cerințe privind bioeconomia și economia circulară. În cadrul Consiliului de astăzi, miniștrii au împărtășit puncte de vedere cu privire la modul în care s-ar putea asigura o orientare mai bună a politicii pentru a face viabil un nou model de afaceri agricole, în special în cadrul bioeconomiei, pentru a încuraja pe fermieri să se îndrepte către inovare și cercetare. Nu în ultimul rând, doresc să vă mulțumesc tuturor pentru buna desfășurare a activităților derulate pe parcursul deținerii de către România a președinției Consiliului Uniunii Europene. Să ne dorim succes!
Thank you. Mulțumim. Commissioner, you have the word.
Thank you very much, President MEP De Castro. First of all, I wish to say that I'm grateful to the Presidency and to Minister Daea personally for his continued focus on the issue we were discussing today, which is the bioeconomy. It reflects its importance to the Romanian Presidency, but also to the wider European Union and the contribution that agri-food and rural development can make. The Presidency's paper encouraged a very well-informed discussion from which I hope we can all learn something. It also, today's discussion highlighted what I believe is an increased acknowledgement and awareness of the importance of the bioeconomy. So I'm not going to repeat what the President has just said, but I'd like to lay some emphasis on a few specific areas. First of all, innovation is key to preparing our agriculture for the future. But innovation is also key to ensuring that the opportunities are availed of as well. There is a great opportunity for jobs and growth in rural areas through the exploitation of the potential of the bioeconomy. We estimate about 1 million jobs can be created between now and 2030. But it must have farmers at the heart of the policy. Farmers must play a huge role in terms of the job creation and the job retention that I speak about. And we have emphasized this in various places over the last number of years, starting with the Cork II Declaration in 2016, where we outlined the principles about what we are speaking about today. And I want to see the Common Agricultural Policy playing its full role in supporting the development of the bioeconomy. The foundation is now in place, and the Council and the new Parliament will have a great opportunity to ensure that we deliver on the way that, in the way that it can. The Finnish Presidency will be taking this forward, building on the work of the Romanian Presidency, in order to deliver and enact practical measures to give effect through programmes in relation to the policies that we wish to implement on the bioeconomy. The Commission is also putting forward €10 billion in our proposal on the MFF for research and innovation, for the food, for the bioeconomy, for natural resources, for agriculture and the environment. So we're putting innovation at the centre of the new CAP, putting our money where our mouth is, and hopefully we'll be in a position to implement rather than talk about the updated European Union bioeconomy strategy. Thank you.
Vice-Presidente, per favore.
First of all, I would like to thank very much the Presidency, Petre, Daea. It was an excellent organization. Everything was working very well, and we appreciate very much the kindness and the welcome warm that we have done these days here in Romania, in Bucharest. The European Parliament, as you know, it was just re-elected, so we have to wait to the beginning of July to have the full committee, Rural and Agricultural Committee in the European Parliament. But we already, of course, are working, and I would like to stress with the same word that Petre and Commissioner Hogan said about research. Agriculture needs more research. Farmers need research and innovation. So we strongly support the proposal of the Commissioner Hogan to increase the budget for research. I think very much that the future challenges we have, we can face only with more innovation. I talked in my speech in the Informal Council about another important aspect of innovation, which is new breeding techniques, the genetic innovations, which we, I hope very much the European Union can have a chance to clarify the point after the Court of Justice sentence. Secondly, I would like to see that this sector, the farmers need more instrument to manage the climate change, to manage the risk, and in this case, it's important innovation at all. And common agricultural policy, of course, should be linked with this important task. So we very much are working hard to do that, and at the end I would like to support Catherine Lenel as a first female candidate. I would like to remember all of you that she was in the European Parliament in February the 18th. It was an excellent interview, and we very much support to have the first women at the chief of FAO. Thank you very much.
Now we will take some questions from your part. Please.
We don't see anything.
I have a question for the Commissioner. I would like to ask you, Rana Rotaru from Antena Una, I would like to ask you if you recommend Romania to implement the traffic light for food as some other countries in the European Union have. So, the traffic light for food, is it a good idea for Romania?
That's a matter for the Minister.
Would you recommend it?
Well, I couldn't possibly intervene in the sovereign right of the minister to make this decision.
Please, let's stress to the subject of our council today. If you have a question about our council, please.
Ținând cont de nevoia taking into account the need to have a more uniform approach to research? Will there be a government program aiming for a better integration of research in order to fight against climate change? Because in Romania, our research institutes have good results, but perhaps we need more funds from the government so that we can work in a uniform way at the national level. Well, the answer is definitely yes, and I'm quite determined to act in this field. I always have the required determination.
The microphone, please.
Thank you very much. Rosa Donovan from Agrifax, a couple of questions, if I may. Minister, I understand that over 20 delegations have said that the time is not ripe right now for a partial general approach on the CAP reform, preferring instead a progress report. What do you say to that? And what are your plans for the June Farm Council? Are bilaterals with ministers still scheduled for June the 17th? Just to give us an idea of your planning for over the next few weeks in terms of this partial general approach. Commissioner Hogan, in the absence of this well-stated partial general approach, will this not make your job more difficult when budget negotiations kick off in earnest after the summer? And another question on another topic, slightly off topic, but still very close to your heart, I'm sure. A technical meeting took place yesterday at DG Agri, combining DG trade officials with member states. And many say that we're in the final lap now in terms of an EU-Mercosur trade deal. What do you say to that? You're playing it down a little, presumably for obvious reasons, let's say, in the negotiation process. And Mr. Paulo de Castro, congratulations on your re-election. A word, perhaps, on the results of the European Parliament election in terms of, I suppose, the end of the majority of the EPP, S&G majority in the European Parliament. How do you foresee that this will shape particularly farm policy and indeed research and innovation going forward? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Let's take it one at a time. I'm waiting for you to put your headphones
poziția
on.
Mea este poziția so fermierilor europeni.
My position is that of the European
tot timpul
farmers.
Noi facem politici
we
pentru
develop
fermierii
policies
europeni
for the benefit
tot
of European farmers.
Am fost și suntem
we
și vom fi ancorați la cerințele lor.
Very close
ei
to
cer
their demands.
Tot timpul
they always
să avem
ask
o politică agricolă comună
for
mai flexibilă,
a more flexible CAP,
o politică agricolă comună mai ușor de implementat, o politică agricolă comună care să satisfacă cerințele fermierilor din țările Uniunii Europene. Din acest punct de vedere, am abordat întreaga președinție și iată că am ajuns astăzi să avem rezultate pe măsura efortului și a interesului pe care l-am dezvoltat în acest domeniu. Am reușit până acum să încheiem un regulament foarte important din setul de trei regulamente care compun politica agricolă comună. Și anume, primul regulament care se referă la planurile strategice care este legat direct de cadrul financiar multianual. Al doilea regulament care înseamnă finanțare, gestionare, monitorizare și al treilea regulament care înseamnă organizare comună de piață. Am lucrat excepțional cu comisia, cu specialiștii de la comisie, cu experții, cu comisarul. Am ajuns astăzi, în cadrul Consiliului Informal, să afirme fiecare ministru din participant la acest Consiliu Informal să aprecieze, spuneam, munca depusă în această direcție. Deci am încheiat organizarea comună de piață, am încheiat regulamentul privind finanțarea, gestionarea și monitorizarea, evident că mai este de lucru privind planurile strategice, întrucât este legat de decizia privind cadrul financiar multianual. Și aici toți miniștrii, majoritatea miniștrilor, gândesc că această abordare generală să o facem la pachet atunci când avem și decizia cu privire la sumele alocate pentru politica agricolă comună.
With what the President has said in relation to the future strategy and process of the CAP, the Minister, President Daea and his team have done an outstanding job in making a lot of progress in relation to the three regulations that he has mentioned. If he did not set an ambition for a partial general approach, well, then you would not get people motivated to actually go as far as we could under the Romanian presidency. And what we have seen is largely agreement around two regulations, but of course it's part of a package. And as the Minister Daea has quite rightly said, tactically and strategically, many member states feel that we should know what's in the MFF in relation to agriculture before we come to conclusions on policy. Yeah. And the minister is a man, you know, like you, he's a different height than I am, but we keep our ears close to the ground, like Mr. De Castro. And, we hear and listen carefully to what ministers are saying, and over these few days of informal meeting, this is where you pick up a lot of certain messages, and he has come to the conclusion, and I support him, that the right thing to do now is to have a progress report in a comprehensive way at the Luxembourg meeting, and then we proceed then to build on that good work, you know, if this is what ministers wish to do in terms of waiting to see the outcome of the MFF. And that's what their desired opinion is. Time will tell whether that's the right strategy or not on behalf of the member states. But the presidency can only listen to the views of the people around the table and reflect that ultimately come to the conclusion as a presidency about what's possible and what's not possible at this moment in time. So I fully support the president's approach of having a comprehensive progress report at the Luxembourg meeting, and then the Finnish presidency can take it from there and hopefully able to conclude a strong budget, which is our ultimate objective for our farmers, and a good policy that simplifies and modernizes the CAP for the next 7 years. On Mercosur, just briefly, there are technical meetings going on for 20 years about Mercosur. So we see that there is progress made, and there is substantial concessions now being made for the first time by countries in the South American bloc. We will see further now as the weeks progress to know, is there a possibility of having a ministerial meeting that will actually conclude these negotiations? But I will have a caveat of warning that we were here before on many occasions.
About the question of AgriFact, the political group equilibrium. Of course, we will have to see the new shape of the Comagri in the next July, but I have to say that I don't see any particular difference of what we have managed today. We don't have a clear majority in the last legislature between PPA and S&D, because we always work with all the groups. You remember the UTP's directive we approved with a very, very large majority of all groups were involved. And as always, the communitary methods is the way how do we join. Sometimes we have more S&D, ALDE, and Greens, and some other times we have PPA and ECR, you know. So it's not a regular majority, of course. So we combine the majority in function of the single subject. So I don't see really a big change of the situation of today, but of course we need to wait 7-8 July.
Okay, next question, please.
Veronica Huza, agricultural prophet. I would have a question for Mr. Hogan. Now there is a big pressure in public pressure and political pressure on taking from market the active substances in agriculture. On the other hand, the Commission wants to have like 10 billions for the research in the next CAP. How do you see this gap between the two approaches against science, let's say, and pro-science in society?
Well, the Commission is very strongly supportive of a science-based approach. and we have EFSA, and we have our chemical agencies. Yes. We have several agencies in the European Union that independently assess each application for approval for plant protection or for any particular pesticide. These have to go through a very rigorous scientific-based process. And some member states, and indeed some members of Council and Parliament, have called this into question in recent times. And therefore, we have had in the Parliament and indeed in the Council an evaluation by Commissioner Andrew Kaitis about how we actually proceed in the future. So we've had recent court decisions in the European Court of Justice as well, which will have an impact on these possibilities in the years ahead. So in the next commission, there will be a proposal that will have to be brought forward for consideration by the Council and the Parliament about how we actually are going to approve these particular applications in the future on active substances or whatever. The 10 billion is necessary for to replace in some way some of the plant protection process products that we have at the moment to deal with pest diseases and other diseases, to deal with treatments that otherwise would mean that we will have the loss of the plants. So I think that we have to be very careful that we do not damage the prospects of actually having food security at the heart of our policy by actually banning all substances that actually can deal with certain treatments. So our research budget, which we are increasing substantially, will play a role in providing alternative product opportunities and alternative solutions to some of the issues that you've raised.
Okay, next question. Please tell us your name and media institution.
Thomas Friedrich, Top Agra. We get a clear picture from you about bioeconomy. I would, the message is clear, research is a solution. We would like to develop a sustainable strategy. Innovation is key. Please, Commissioner and President, can you make it a bit clear, what can pharma expect in the future? Not only 10 billion from Horizon Europe budget, but what mean it concrete for the future of food production and farmers in particular? And second question, if I may, for Mr. Di Castro. I'm a bit astonished to hear from your side that you see no change after the new EU elections. The majority has changed, as you described yourself. So you cannot imagine that the CAP reform will be revised. Thank you.
Well, in relation to the bioeconomy, I see farmers having a very central role in being the provider of raw materials. Of course, we have a view at the moment about what traditional raw materials are, but we have to broaden the base of these raw materials to other products and other commodities so that farmers will get the benefit of producing those particular commodities and hopefully through producer organizations or cooperatives be involved in the downstream and upstream activities in relation to providing the jobs for our rural areas and the income for our farmers. So this is an opportunity where farmers can be centrally involved in providing more income for themselves and also more jobs for rural areas. And we will be introducing programs and opportunities for investments that farmers can draw down, that kind of cooperatives and producers organizations can draw down in order to make this happen. This is going to be a very important part of the CAP strategic plan, and the proposals from the member states will get financial support when they decide to prioritize this.
Evident, vom regăsi
ca
răspuns la întrebarea noastră în planurile strategice.
The response, the answer to your questions can be found in the strategic plan.
Pas cu pas această modalitate de realizare a planurilor strategice, în așa fel încât instrumentele pentru bioeconomie să se găsească pentru fiecare țară în parte în planul strategic pe care și-l propune pentru viitoarea politică agricolă comună 21-27, beneficiind de elasticitatea conceptului și posibilitatea de a și defini fiecare țară în parte drumul în acest domeniu. Și în completare, evident, această sumă care nu este mică la nivelul Uniunii Europene de 10 miliarde pentru cercetare și inovare, care va sta la dispoziția celor care merg pe acest drum al inovării.
One last question, please.
Just a moment, I have to answer.
Okay.
You. May I?
Okay.
I have to answer. First of all, let me say that I totally agree with the Commissioner Hogan when he said about scientific basis approach, which is the approach of the Parliament. in the large majority. Well, no, I was answering to the AgraFac question about the power between PPA and S&D, because even in the past, we didn't have such a strong alliance all the legislature, but change depending of the subject. But of course, I agree with you, everything will change. We'll change the chair, we'll change the rapporteur, we'll change the coordinator. So we need to understand now the new shape of the Comagri. But from the political group side, I don't think it will be a tremendous change, even if some anti-European groups will have one or two more members, because the large majority we still have in the European, pro-European groups.
Okay, two more questions, please.
Thanks, Eddie Wax, Politico. I've got a question for Commissioner Hogan. So the budget is not the only outstanding issue which is blocking the finalization of the strategic plan's file. There's also some disagreement, or there's a split, 50-50 split in the council about eco-schemes, which is one of the main new green parts of the CAP. I've been reliably informed that the Commission is unhappy about some member states trying to water down the environmental ambitions of the new CAP. So what has been the Commission's message to those member states, and how confident is the Commission about getting the environmental green scope of its initial plans passed in the Council?
Okay.
Well, I don't know where you got your 50-50 from. I don't know what, because it wasn't discussed in the Council today. So maybe in the back room there might be something going on that I don't know about. But certainly you want to be very careful when you make calculations about what's going on. There are some concerns about how the eco-schemes will be implemented, which is normal, because people want to be sure before they vote about how they will actually apply in practice. And we have proposed that there would be mandatory for the member state to offer them, but voluntary for the farmers if they wish to participate. I think this is a very reasonable. If we have member states who regularly lecture us about the need for to implement matters relating to environment and climate ambition, surely they will have no difficulty then in improving the response of the agricultural sector, and surely they will have no difficulty about the fact that we are doubling the level of ambition in terms of financial aspects of the CAP through the MFF from 20% to 40%. So let's hear what the alternative proposals are, but we have no choice, in my view. But every sector has to play its part in meeting the Paris Agreement objectives and targets, as well as the Sustainable Development Goals. And I have not heard any alternatives coming forward yet to how we're going to have an ambitious green architecture for the CAP, and one that is simple as well, because the present system is not working and it's too complex.
Thank you. One last question, please.
Vere. Fermierii își pot asigura culturile împotriva
So do you have figures that could tell us how many Romanian farmers have such insurance policies and how many EU farmers do?
Well, we haven't compared the figures between Romania and the other countries,
but there is a common tool that we have in our National Rural Development Plan that we set in motion, and we ask our farmers to take on insurance policies, and 50% of the cost is covered from the funds of the National Rural Development Program. So each farmer is welcome, mai ales în aceste situații, pentru că se vede ce este afară, ca fermierii să intre pe aceste culoare de sprijin atât de necesar și zic eu că valoros și merită să-l folosim cum o facem de altfel. Sigur, o serie întreagă de instrumente financiare pe care le-am introdus și aici beneficiez de prezența și să-i mulțumesc comisarului că am introdus aici un instrument excepțional cu un acord cu FEIU pentru pentru a avea împrumuturi avantajoase pentru fermieri. O să mergem peste câteva minute la o conferință pentru a participa la discuțiile care se vor purta pe aceste teme, chiar astăzi în București. Sunt instrumente pe care trebuie să le folosim. There are instruments that we have to use.
Domnule comisar, dumneavoastră aveți o viziune de ansamblu privind măsura sau procentul în care fermierii încheie asigurări în Europa?
Farmers or what percentage of them take such insurance policies in Europe?
There's about less than 10% of farmers that program risk management tools, of which insurance products are just one. And we, with the help of the successive presidency and Mr. De Castro, through the omnibus regulation 2 or 3 years ago in the Parliament and the Council and the Commission, came together to improve the bargaining position of farmers in the food chain, to ban unfair trading practices for the first time ever, to improve the legislation that gives better collective bargaining possibilities for farmers, but also to improve risk management tools generally. We have to do more in this proposal of the CAP reform to do better for farmers at times of difficulty, whether it is climate action or flooding or drought, or whether it is disease, or whether it is earthquakes, or whatever the natural disaster is. We have to have a crisis reserve that works. We have to have insurance products and mutual funds that work, and we have to program them with the help of income stabilisation tools. This is what we have agreed. Now it's about implementation, for the member states, and it's up to them to program them. But they're available now.
Yes.
Thank you.
Roana Rotaru de la Antena 1, aș mai avea o întrebare pentru domnul ministru.
I have another question. Să întreb
ce fac autoritățile acum ca să semnalizeze la raft dacă un produs este sănătos sau nu, și dacă ar fi potrivit să implementăm și în România semaforul alimentar cum are și Belgia.
Vă adresăm rugămintea să...
Sunt teme care prezintă importanță pentru astăzi și pentru noi toți. Mi-aș rezerva timp pentru a discuta aceste teme într-o viitoare conferință de presă, dat fiind faptul că acum suntem în această situație când avem două personalități ce participă la Consiliul Informal de la București cu o temă precisă și urmează să ne deplasăm și în altă parte pentru a aborda temele zilei, sigur, ca și cum, din gradul acesta de înțelegere pentru dumneavoastră, aș scoate dorința de a participa la o conferință de presă pe această temă. Acum să lăsăm tiparul zilei și să beneficiem de această întâlnire extrem de importantă și pe care o avem cu toții astăzi, dat fiind de momentul acesta de desfășurare a Consiliului Uniunii Europene.
Thank you all for your interest. Have a nice day.
Very well indeed.